Welcome to Swing State. I'm your host, Fox 8 senior political reporter Bob Buckley. And with me tonight is Nigel Bristow, the Democratic candidate for North Carolina's 9th Congressional District. Welcome.
Thank you.
You're a New Yorker.
Yes, sir.
Grew up on Staten Island, 20 years as a detective with the NYPD. That had to be both fun and arduous.
Yes, very challenging and exciting all in the same time.
What did it teach you about life?
Taught me that at any moment, anything can happen. Mm-hmm. Always expect the unexpected.
Yeah. So what brought you back here? You came home to a degree, right?
Right. I retired from the police department and I wanted to move to a calmer setting.
Okay. Yeah.
I wanted to be able to have a higher quality of life and a lower cost of living. So mm-hmm. I relocated to where my family is from, which is Hamlet, North Carolina.
And my understanding is it's on perhaps some land that your great-grandfather owned?
That's right. I had a house built on his land.
That's got to be special.
It is. It is.
Yeah. Do you know much about him?
Just a little, you know, from what my mother's told me. He was very active in the, mm-hmm. our family church, which I became a member of, and now I'm a deacon in that same church.
Wow. And so, you know, I don't know whether that kind of goes together, I would think, being a detective and seeing all the rough side of life. You kind of want something at the other end that's healing and brings people together and life-affirming, I guess.
That's right.
Yeah, so a pretty big church down there?
Well, it's a small congregation, but mm-hmm. it's Livingston Chapel Missionary Baptist Church. Mm-hmm. We have a saying, it's the little church by the side of the road that's a friend to all.
Nice, very nice. Living in Anson County is where you were working as a probation and parole officer, correct?
Yes.
So second career, kind of.
Yes.
You get that advantage when you get retired after 20 years, I guess, in some of those big cities. A probation and parole officer with the Department of Adult Correction. So I imagine the shooting in Charlotte last month had to hit you pretty hard.
It did. You know, currently I'm a chief of probation, and two of the officers killed were a member of Department of Adult Corrections task force working mm-hmm. with the U.S. Marshals. So those officers were known to some of my officers. You know, we've worked with them and corresponded with them. And anytime a police officer gets killed, it hits close to home.
Absolutely. And people may not think of adult correction as being quite as dangerous as the frontline police officers, but they were in this case.
That's right, because they were, you know, serving a warrant, someone that was wanted for a crime, and unfortunately, you know, they were killed.
North Carolina Senator Tom Tillis just introduced legislation to make harming a law enforcement officer like those last month a federal crime. Traditionally, you know, murder and other similar crimes are local or state. Would you be behind something like that?
100%.
Yeah?
100%.
But what degree does it get entangled in who gets jurisdiction and all that type of stuff when you're trying to do a federal version and a state version?
Well, here's the way I look at it. Okay. When you become a police officer, you swear to an oath. That's an oath to uphold the state constitution and the United States Constitution. So right there, you're in defense of the United States Constitution, and you get killed. Mm-hmm. So there's your jurisdiction, in my opinion.
Sure. And again, you're in Anson County, where you're the chief probation and parole officer. That is on the border with South Carolina. Tell me a little bit about how that experience is maybe different than your detective experience.
Well, that's the interesting thing. As a detective, you know, you investigate the crime, you arrest those responsible, you go to court, you testify, and that's where it ends. Now, with probation and parole, you work the other side once they come out, post-conviction, whether it's probation or parole. And now you're tasked with preventing that individual from returning to a life of crime. And it's interesting because you're tasked with identifying those needs that person has and addressing those needs so they don't reoffend.
Yeah, I think you're very sharp here because you're taking me right where I wanted to go next, which is the fact that you're the chairman of the Richmond County Reentry Council, correct?
That's right.
This has been a real issue I've done stories on, has been sort of a pet project of mine, trying to help people become productive citizens again after they've served their time, because I've always argued that the greatest capital we have is human capital. We throw so much of it away. We will put people in prison or jail, put these heavy stigma on them, and they come out and we just kind of say, no, go ahead, you're on your own. How do we expect them to be successful when we just abandon them like that? What do we need to do to help people be reenter successfully?
All right, so ideally with the reentry program, where we identify those individuals that are about to be released, usually it's within 9 months or so, mm-hmm. and we pair them with an officer on the outside to work with them to get them paired with employment, mm-hmm. education if they need it. If they have mental health issues, identify them with a provider on the outside. If they have medical issues, the same thing. And that way, once they're released, it should be pretty much a smooth transition to the outside.
So we are doing a lot.
Yes.
But our recidivism rate is still there.
Well, it is, but it's a lot lower than it was, mm-hmm. thanks to these reentry projects, which are reemerging through all 100 counties. Eventually, that's the goal. Also with behavioral modification through mm-hmm. What we call cognitive behavioral intervention, which is through group therapy.
And I mean, what are you finding? That there are certainly some that it's almost impossible to get back on the right track. How do I identify those that are going to reoffend? Can you? Does your experience alone give you that insight?
It does, because you'd be surprised. Now, we deal with, in the probation world, with a risk needs analysis. Mm-hmm. And so that's one-on-one with the officer and the client, if you will. And based on that risk needs analysis, we could determine their rate that they would likely succeed or not. And if we mm-hmm. see that they're high risk, then there are certain things that we would do to try to minimize that risk.
Is there a lot more you would advocate for in this reentry idea if you're in Congress?
Yes. It's all about partnerships, all right, mm-hmm. community-based resources. So whatever is needed to make sure that those resources are paired with these individuals is what we need to do.
Can you understand the reticence of some businesses who say, you know, I just don't want to take that risk?
Well, that very well may be. However, in order to be successful, all right, these individuals are coming back to our community no matter what. And they're our friends, they're our neighbors, they're our family. So they need jobs. Employers need workers. So they're going to come to a point where they're going to say, all right, I'll give it a shot.
And as a former detective and probation officer and parole officer, Nigel is very familiar with gun violence in America. We'll talk about solutions for that when we get back. Welcome back to Swing State. Tonight we're talking with the Democratic candidate for North Carolina's 9th Congressional District seat, Nigel Bristow. Welcome back, Mr. Bristow. So let's talk a little bit about you. Are, as we mentioned earlier, in case you're just joining us, Mr. Bristow spent 20 years as a detective in New York City and now is a probation parole officer here in North Carolina. The amount of gun violence in this country, though, must disturb you.
It does.
What do we do about it?
Well, it's hard to say, but, you know, what could help is sensible gun legislation.
Which is what? Because we hear that, and of course, well, who's against sensible, right?
Well, so, for example,
yeah.
All right, so 34 years law enforcement experience I have, I carry a handgun off duty. Mm-hmm. I have to have a license to carry that handgun. Whereas like a military style weapon, an AR-15, you know, you don't need a license. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to necessarily be 21. So something like that would be a good start.
We've heard the admonition all the time, of course, that the criminals by definition don't pay attention to the law, so they're gonna ignore the law, and the law-abiding citizens are the ones who become unarmed. How do you answer that?
Well, I mean, the thing is, you have a right to defend yourself, and you know, if you can get a license to carry a weapon or defend your home, you should have that right.
Yeah. But of course, we're trying to keep the guns out of the hands of the other guys,
that's right.
Which is easier said than done. You are the father of two young kids, so I need to bring this up because it seems to me the most impactful thing, not just seems to me, all the research shows, nothing affects a kid's success like a father who's involved. Ideally, the father and mother in the same house, but it doesn't have to be. The research is now showing that if the father is still very involved, I want to show you some statistics that will back this up, and you can take a quick look at them, then we'll talk about them. The poverty rate for married couple families, less than 11%. For female-headed households, it's nearly 50%, more than four times as high. 71% of high school dropouts are from fatherless homes, nine times the national average. Kids with involved fathers are 43% more likely to earn A's in school and twice as likely to enter college, 75% less likely to have a teenage birth, 80% less likely to spend time in jail, and five times as likely to commit suicide. Again, that is people, kids growing up without fathers involved in their lives. If we had a government program that had the type of success that a father in the home had, it would have unanimous support in Congress and it would have all the funding it needs, but nobody seems to want to talk about this. Why?
Well, it's hard to say. As far as, you know, having, you know, when fathers are more involved, yes, it's more successful because, you know, we try to lead by example. So the children see the father and the mother successful and they have successful employment and, you know, whether they go to church or they do the right thing, children need to see that from day to day. And if there's something going on in the news or something happens at school, they need to be able to come home and talk to someone about it, someone they know, someone they trust.
Yeah, and I've often said children will sometimes hear what you say, they will always watch what you do, to your point of the example. But it's so many things, it's, you know, it's any single parent, it's hard to do it on your own. So if you have both of them there, you cut that work rate down. You've got men and women are often different characteristics and personalities, they bring different things to it. Can you, would you, would, when you see these type of numbers, I would hope it would say, to you or any candidate, we've got to find a way to make this happen.
That's right, and it helps with, see, the main thing, the main role for government is to make people's lives better, okay? So we need to find out basically what's needed in these communities, what resources are needed, and pair the community with these resources to help them, whether it's childcare or, you know, or just, you know, a higher minimum wage so that the children can go to work and be productive. It's a number of things.
Well, let's talk about that because that is big. The legislative issues, domestic issues, seem to be high on your radar when you look at your website and other things you put out. You've campaigned for making life affordable for seniors, you mentioned, things like protecting Medicaid, Medicare, Social Security, as well as affordable housing and transportation. How do we make Medicare and Medicaid more supportive? Because they take an immense amount of our money.
Well, without already being there and knowing how the inner workings are in Congress, basically, you know, we have to take care of our elderly like they once took care of us.
Yeah.
So if it costs money, you know, we're going to have to pay the money to protect.
Well, right now, we are, our healthcare system, we spend $4.5 trillion. That's back in 2022, the last year we have numbers for, according to the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, the federal government. That's $13,500 per person, so $54,000 for a family of four, 70% of our GDP. That healthcare spending is killing us.
Well, if we don't have healthcare, we're going to die. So it's something that, you know, we're going to have to figure it out.
Okay, understandable. The U.S. House just, U.S. House Committee just released a report saying that the U.S. is spending more than $8,700 per migrant who has entered the country illegally. And Americans are struggling and they see that type of thing and they were like, wow, you know, I'm struggling and we're spending all this money on people who came here illegally. Any thoughts on that?
Well, my question would be, we're spending that money to do what exactly?
Yeah.
Okay. For example, if we have migrant children that come in unaccompanied, we have to put them somewhere. We have to keep them safe, keep them out of harm's way. That's going to cost money to find a place to put them.
Well, I think there are a lot of people who will say we need to find a way to prevent them from coming in the first place.
Agreed, but once they're here, they're our responsibility. We have to do something.
No idea of perhaps sending them back to their homeland.
Well, you know, our immigration policy, you know, we have to evaluate it. You know, we need to evaluate and evolve. What used to work is not working today and certainly won't work tomorrow.
Would you be for securing the border, perhaps building a wall or putting the military on the border?
Well, the military on the border seems like, you know, a heavy-handed step, mm-hmm. okay? Our military is stretched now, pretty thin. You know, we need to find a more appropriate way. Yes, we need to secure the border, but we need to find an appropriate way to do it.
Very good. All right, well, I want to ask all of you out there, are you making enough money, making what you're worth? Our guest tonight might have something to say about that when we come back. Welcome back to Swing State. I'm Bob Buckley, and we're talking with Nigel Bristow, who is the Democratic candidate for the 9th Congressional District in North Carolina, which is the heart of which is in Guilford, Alamance, and Randolph counties, and then runs down through Chatham, Moore, Hoak, and part of Cumberland County. You know, you talk about what you'd like to see people have be able to work for a living wage or a wage they can live on. What is that level?
Well, right now, roughly, the federal minimum wage is $7.25 an hour, and so is the minimum wage in North Carolina, and that's just not practical, okay?
I understand what you're saying. To support a family, it certainly is not practical. Styrofoam is a wonderful product, but I wouldn't build my car out of it, right. Meaning that if you're trying to support a family on a minimum wage, you're using it for the wrong purpose, that we shouldn't look to try to make those jobs family supportable. Would you agree or no?
Yes, I would agree. However, there's some employers that base their rate somewhat on that minimum wage. And if that mm-hmm. wage is so low, you know, they may not offer that much.
Right, but if I'm trying to support a family, that's not a job I'm gonna be looking to do.
Right, but unfortunately, that may be mm-hmm. the only job you can get at the time.
Part of that problem is people didn't have those jobs, because those jobs are largely going to go away. The higher we raise that minimum wage, the more the businesses look to eliminate those jobs. They'll automate them out of, because they're often very repetitive jobs. You know, jobs where you're doing a repetitive action. And with AI and computers, they can find ways to just eliminate that job. And then how do kids learn to work? I mean, a job working at McDonald's, like my little brother did right out of when he was in high school, or I was a paper boy. It taught you how to get up, how to show up, how to take care of your job, how to handle criticism. And I worry that young kids, if they don't have the minimum wage jobs that are not designed to support a family, they won't have those opportunities.
Well, I mean, that's a small risk.
Okay. You still go for you still think we need a higher
yes.
minimum wage, and we don't, and no particular figure for that?
No, I would say that would have to vary by, you know, mm-hmm. the area. Or the city that you live in.
If you're in Congress, you'll have a lot of international questions to answer too. What is your reaction to seeing the protests on college campuses and in cities? You can define them. It's either pro-Palestinian, pro-Hamas, anti-Israel. There are a lot of different definitions. What do you make of them?
Well, we have the First Amendment rights. Students should have a right to protest. Peaceful protest should not be condemned. They should be allowed to speak what they feel.
Where do we draw that line, though? Because there are some accusations that the protests in your former home city of New York went well beyond a peaceful protest, destroying and taking over buildings, harassing the Jewish students at Columbia. Does that cross the line in your view?
Well, anytime violence comes into play and people get hurt, that's gone too far on either side. So, you know, we have to find a way where the protests can speak their peace or to speak their truth mm-hmm. and it not becoming violent.
If you're in Congress, you'll have the obligation to vote on some of these things. Would you vote to support Israel's right to destroy Hamas? Because that's leading to the collateral damage that they can't avoid because Hamas uses civilians as shields. And Hamas is very open. Their leaders say proudly, we all have to be martyrs. Yes, we use, you know, the people who are our shields are part of the martyrdom process. What do you do in that case if you have to vote on this? These are not easy votes.
No, they certainly are not. The bottom line is people are dying. So we have to figure out a way to stop the dying, stop the killing. If there's a diplomatic way we can do that, then that's something we need to look into.
Yeah, I think Israel's point is until Hamas is destroyed, the dying is going to continue one way or the other. It's going to be either Israelis dying at Hamas's hands or Hamas will die at their hands. What about Ukraine? Have you thought about whether you would support the continued munitions and financial support for Ukraine?
Well, I think we need to continue to support Ukraine because it's democracy. It's what we do as a country. We promote and we support democracy. And to think of what would happen if we turned our backs and then Ukraine would fall, you know, what would the ramifications be then?
Yeah, I mean, probably go through the rest of the non-NATO countries that used to be in the Soviet Union. Then, of course, China's watching all this. China's waiting to take back Taiwan, which they see as their own. These are dangerous times to want to be a member of Congress. I mean, there's some heady issues.
That's right.
So why do you want to do this? What's driving you to run?
Well, all my life I've been spent defending, protecting, serving, and listening to people. Okay, so the Constitution says that Congress was enacted to be the voice of the people. And right now that voice has been silenced. Just as I go out and tour the district, people are telling me they feel that their representatives no longer represent them anymore. That they've fallen on deaf ears. They've forgotten who sent them to Washington in the first place. Mm-hmm. And every day they see chaos in Congress through the different hearings that, you know, is really, you know, it's terrible for them to watch. Meanwhile, they're suffering here at home. Mm-hmm.
When you saw what happened in the George Floyd situation, his death, how did that affect you and the protests that followed?
Well, anytime, you know, a person dies at the hands of police custody, you know, it's a polarizing event. Again, it's just, you know, it's going to create, you know, dissension. You know, it's going to create a mistrust. You mm-hmm. know, the police are going to have to really, you know, pretty much still continue to do their job despite what the public sentiment is.
Not easy, as you know, as a former officer.
That's right.
And really an officer, too, still in a way. Mm-hmm. Well, Mr. Bristow, good luck. Again, you're running for the 9th District here in North Carolina against the incumbent Richard Hudson, the Republican. Mr. Bristow is the Democratic nominee, and that is it for us tonight. Please tune in or set your DVR to record Swing State each week to get the kind of in-depth look at the key issues that shape our community. We'll see you next time.